Hello and welcome to Talking Points here on France 24. No more four-wheel drives, diesel-fueled vehicles in the center of major French town. Is this possible? Well, the Ministry of Environment has designated several cities, including Paris and Lyon, to test traffic limitations for the most polluting vehicles and create so-called priority zones for the atmosphere in 2012. Such mechanisms are already in place in several European cities, including London, Berlin, or Rome. Will it work in France? More importantly, will it help curb pollution? So with me to discuss the issue here today is Ali Fatemi, who is a professor of finance at the American Graduate School of Business and Economics here in Paris. Hello and welcome. And also on the set is Rémi Ourlier, who is better known as Rémi Bricoltou, which translates more or less in Rémi Fixes Everything.
Fixes Everything, yeah.
You're a journalist and an automobile specialist. Hello and welcome to you too.
Hello.
Mr. Fatemi, as someone who lives in Paris, the government says it's really important to protect the health of the people, to have less polluting vehicles in the center of town. Is this a good idea?
I think so. I think it's a good idea. Whether you can do that by banning the cars with diesel fuel or you can make better cars is something that should be examined. But I think in general it's a good idea. Paris has been a model for many cities. I think, for instance, the Espace Civilisé that happened in Paris, what they did with the buses and so on, is being repeated in 34th Street in New York City. People are looking at Paris nowadays as a place where many innovative things, like the bicycle, the thing that they have in Paris and so on. And I think it's a good initiative. However, one should not go too far on these things. I think one should look at not only the economic and environmental aspects of it, but also consider people who live in town. After all, towns are for people and not vice versa.
What's your view on this?
My view is, of course, pollution is a big problem, and it has to be solved one way or another. The only thing is, I don't think that by targeting 4x4s, you're targeting the right. I mean, you're getting the right people. I'm not sure of that at all. Because, you see, a 4x4 has the same engine as a big passenger car. So why the 4x4 and not the big passenger car? Who pollutes? I think this needs to be at least thought about, because it's not as simple as it looks. I mean, a 4x4 is a very good scapegoat. That's what I think.
Right, but I mean, it's not only 4x4. It's diesel fueled, and it might be, you know, big trucks, or we don't know yet.
We don't know yet, right? But you see, in France, they have pushed diesel ever since 1980s, I would say. The first very good diesel that we had here was the Golf diesel. Before that, they were not very good, and there were not that many. But the first Golf diesel came out in 1975, roughly, 78, 75, 78. It's ever since the solution was pushed as far as transporting people was diesel. And now we're finding out that diesel is not the right solution. Well, that was obvious. I mean, Peugeot, Jacques Calvé's Peugeot, Peugeot's Jacques Calvé was pushing 100% diesel production for Peugeot. And who in his right mind would think that was the right solution, knowing that when you come back, after a walk in Paris, you come back and you do this and you find a very black cotton here.
Right, but I mean, it's a different thing when a car maker like Peugeot pushes for diesel because their objective is not necessarily health concerns, but to sell cars. I mean, now it's the Ministry of Environment who's saying, okay, we need to do things about this because there are around 40,000 deaths per year because of exposition to fine particles. So we need to do something. I mean, do you think that public health concerns will prevail over what is likely to be resistance from the automobile lobby here in France?
Well, I think it should. We talk about four-wheel drive. Four-wheel drive is for the countryside. People who drive four-wheel drives in Paris or a Hummer in Paris, this has become a status symbol. And it has no place in a city. In a city where it snows once every 10 years, you know, what do you need a four-wheel drive? If you live, let's say, in some countryside in northern hemisphere or something, I could see it. So that's one thing. The other problem that I think we have in this respect is the congestion. Congestion, the size of the car matters in Paris. I don't think Paris is made for huge, big cars. And that, as you said, it could also be for big American-sized cars also. These are considerations that in a city you have to somehow find a solution for conflicting interests, for people who live in the city, for other people who want to come in the city. Now, how you do this, there are different ways. One way, of course, is the financial manner, as they do in London and Stockholm or other places, that when you drive in the center of the city or the kind of car that you have to pay for it. Now, that creates some problems. But my question basically is that social cost is always neglected. Auto people have people who speak for them. Transport people, the interest is always presented or represented. But average person, the kind of people whose health is in danger, whose safety is in danger, don't have anybody who speaks for them. And that's where government comes in. And measures like this, even though they will be resisted, I think they're necessary to protect the public.
They're necessary.
Yes, but the situation that we have now in Paris, as far as congestion goes, is a situation that is planned. I mean, the mayor of Paris has built huge bus lanes, has reduced traffic, has reduced traffic paths, has reduced parking. Immense streets of parking have been, just banned parking or put bicycles instead. And so you don't know how to park. And now even a motorcycle can't really go through, because if you have a motorway and you turn it into a trail, well, I mean, a trail, there's one car behind the other, and that's the best you can do on a trail, because you reduced this is a thrombosis. That's exactly what they did to Paris. So now, after having done that, they find out that the situation is unbearable. Well, that's easy. Anybody could have said that. I mean, that's very simple. Just cut off the streets, just block them completely, and you'll find that people won't be able to travel from one place to another. So that depends what you want.
Yeah.
It's just getting, it's doing. I was on the circulation commission of my village. And I asked my mayor, who had given me the I was working on that, and I drew very quickly, saying, people go from there. There's no east west problem, but there's a north south problem, because we have a bridge. Where I live, there's a bridge over the motorway. The motorway is like a river. You can only cross at the bridge. So everybody just funnels to the bridge. So I say, What is the aim of the circulation commission? Is it to block people from coming, or to facilitate their passing? What do you want to do? What is the goal? And nobody could answer. Nobody knows. It's just like the only thing is, well, let's just do as best as we can with And there are no precise goals. If there's a precise goal, you know how to implement it to
reach
that.
Right, but there are conflicting goals, maybe. One way is to, you need traffic to transport, and for the economy, the other is protect the health, okay. avoid traffic jams, and so on.
Take pollution, for example. I mean, how is it when you have to circle the block 5, 6, 7, 8, 10 times to find a parking space? Don't you think you pollute a bit? How about having the buses? Paris is probably the most visited city in the world. Now, we have buses coming from all over the place. I mean, from Poland, from Italy, from Spain, from everywhere, with busloads of tourists. Okay, what do these buses do when the tourists are off to visit the monument? They just stay there, and they keep the motor on to get the air conditioning working, and they don't go to the. There's one place where the buses could park. It's more expensive to park the bus than to keep it running around, and okay. After that, you find out you have a pollution problem. Come on.
No, I think we have to define what we're discussing here. Basically, we're talking about people who drive into Paris with big cars or with any car who really don't have to do it. Those who need to travel and to, for some reason, either physical or social, have to have a car to drive to Paris, fine. But I don't see the reason why everybody has to come to Paris with a private car. I gave up using my car in Paris years ago, and I'm totally comfortable with public transport.
But you're a Parisian. You live in Paris.
But we are talking about Paris. But you see, other people who come from outside of Paris, they could park there. Look at New York City. Look at other big cities. There are huge parking lots outside of the city. You leave your car and you take a public transport.
Where have you
and
seen you the huge parking lot? I'd like to know the address of the big parking lot.
But these things can be done. What I'm saying is nobody says just ban it outright. But these things can be done by plan. We are talking about private and social cost, and these two always diverge. Every time that people try to increase their personal things, they push the cost to the public. And that's the problem. I didn't vote for this mayor the first time, but I'm sure next time he runs, I'm going to vote for it. I think he has been a very good mayor because he's the first one who does not listen to private interest, which is always has a lot of a spokesman, and worries about the average person in the street. And that's very important in a city like
but
Paris.
But don't you think, quickly, that... public opinion will continue pressuring for a better quality of life, quality of the atmosphere in the city, and therefore it's going to be very difficult for cars to have the upper hand when it comes to downtowns.
You're absolutely right. The only problem is that public transport, departs from where you're not, and goes to where you don't want to go. That's the main problem. And the car is sitting outside your door, and it's ready for you, and you walk into it, and then you go wherever you want to go, and you park normally right next to where you want to go. So the car is a very versatile equipment, whereas public transport isn't. My case, for example, I have miles to walk to find public transport, miles to walk. And it takes hours to go into Paris with the public transport. So I'm suburban. I live 6 kilometers out of Paris.
So may I say, for instance, one of the plans that the city of Paris is considering is to have the rental cars, the same thing that they has this for the bicycles, for
now,
you to take a car and go wherever you want. In other words, leave your car at the before you enter the city and take one of those cars and leave it and somebody else will take it. I mean, there are many ways of doing this thing, but the essential fact is that I guess we all agree. I just saw a Hummer on the screen. Now, what does a Hummer have to do in Paris? This was built for war in Iraq, and now it's become... These are the kind of excesses which I think have to be stopped.
Okay, we have
the
to...
The Hummer's not a diesel, I think.
Okay. We'll continue this discussion after we wrap up the program. Thank you very much to both of you. We'll see how Paris and other big French cities look like in a few years, whether there'll be more cars or more people walking. Thank you for watching Talking Points here on France 24.